Welcome back to our microeconomics session. Now, so far we have finished the theory of perfect competition and what perfect competition implies in terms of revenue and the cost for a supplier. Now, although the rationalized syllabus of your curriculum for this academic year does not include the imperfect competition, but in order to understand the equilibrium that exists in real life market, we need to study the basics of our imperfect competition. Now, when we talk about perfect competition, in the first lecture I told you that the perfect competition is nothing but an idealized concept, correct? You cannot find the perfect competition in real life. Some industries come very close to it, but there is no such concept as a perfect competition in practical sense, correct? For example, when you take the example of firms that sell water, packaged drinking water. So they have homogeneous products and the prices are determined by the market forces, correct? So these type of some industries come very close to be recognized as perfect competition, but there are also other firms which make the imperfect competition in the market. We are going to study the first imperfect competition, that is the monopoly. Now, the word monopoly has been used in general sense since very beginning of the time. The monopoly, the word mono means single, right? And poly is the supplier or the seller. So when you say monopoly, you know that this market talks about only one seller, mono seller, one seller, correct? So we are going to understand some features of this monopoly market and then we will understand how economic profit is determined in the monopoly market, correct? So one thing regarding the imperfect competition you have to understand here is that basics of identifying these markets into different types is the constitution of the market, means the numbers of buyers and sellers and how they behave regarding a particular price of the product in the market. So let's start with seeing what are the features. The first feature here says single seller and large number of buyers. Now when you say monopoly, you are distinguishing the market in the terms of a seller. So seller may be single, but the buyers are large, the huge number of buyers, correct? So a market structure where there is a single seller and large number of buyers, that market is called as the monopoly market. Now, being the single seller, what implication does it have? When you say single seller, you mean that there is only one firm. I am not saying single seller means this particular individual only. You have to understand this in market, that when you talk about single seller, you are talking about a single particular type of firms that exist in the market, correct? For example, if I say a pharmaceutical company, so there will be only one company which sells the pharmaceutical products. Means, I am not saying there will be one firm. I am saying there will be n number of firms, but they will sell the pharmaceutical products. So pharmaceuticals is the monopoly here, okay? So here we have just a single seller. We assume that in a monopoly market, there is a single seller who controls the entire market. Means you can say that there is a one-man show, right? Like in terms of sole proprietorship, I think you have seen that there is only one person who controls the business. Similarly, in the huge economic sense, you can understand that monopoly means there is a single firm operating in the market, single seller in the market with large number of buyers. So what type of control does he have? That whatever goods he has to sell, only those goods the consumers will demand. Because if he, whatever he sells, if you don't purchase that, you will have no other option to substitute. Means the products that they sell have no close substitute. That brings us to our second feature, means the differentiated products. Now it is very simple that if you as a person are the single seller in the market, will you sell goods which are substitutes of each other? No, Why? Because let's say I am selling product A and product B, which happen to be substitutes of each other. And product A is little more expensive than the product B, then obviously being a rational consumer, the consumers will shift to product B because it is comparatively inexpensive. It is at a reasonable price. So lower the price, greater will be the demand. So that as a producer, I will find very, not profit making, not beneficial. So that becomes a problem for me because both the products are mine. I am producing and I am selling those products. And if I keep substitute products available with me, I will only incur loss. And being a ruthless profit maximizer, I will not want to do that. That is why all the products that I sell in the market as a monopolist, means monopolist is the seller of monopoly market, right? As a monopolist, I will always want to sell what? Differentiated products, means these products have no close substitutes. My products will have no substitutes available in the market. Primary reason is because there is no other seller in the market. I am the only mono seller, single seller in the market, and I have control over all the operations of the market. Moving forward, then comes our most important element of monopoly market, is that of price making behavior. And here it is said that the seller is price maker. Now, it is not a rocket science. When you are the only person controlling the market, it obviously means that you are the one who makes the prices. You are the one who determines at what price shall the product be sold. Correct? You are controlling the market, means you are obviously controlling the price element as well. You are determining at what cost you are producing the good, and you are determining at what price it should be sold, means you are determining your profit margin of all the products that you sell in the market. Having said that, this is the most important factor, and this will determine the level of our economic profits as well. So for a price maker firm, how will he try to maximize his profit? Is by charging high prices. But having to study this in detail, one thing you have to understand, that if you are a person who is controlling the market and you are the person who is a price maker and you have the authority to charge as much as price as you like, will it be okay if you charge arbitrarily high prices? Like for a pen of, let's say, 10 rupees, if you are charging 3 times more, if you are charging 30 rupees or let's say 50 rupees, will it be acceptable in the market? Honestly, practically, no. But then in monopoly, you tell me, do the consumers have any other option? Also no, because there are no close substitutes in the market. They have no choice. They can either purchase that product at whatever price the monopolist decides or to go without it. And if, for example, let's say that product is of necessity for your survival, then you cannot actually go without that product. So you will have to demand at whatever price the monopolist sets, correct? But in a real life situation, a monopolist, if he wants to increase his market share, will not charge arbitrarily high prices. Of course, he will charge prices more than what reasonable price should be. That is too simple, because he is a producer and he is a ruthless profit maximizer. He will not think too much into it. He will charge a bit higher prices, but it will not be arbitrarily high or higher than what, you know, a particular limit has to be set. Okay, so when he is a price maker, we will, in the further sessions, we will see how economic profits are decided for a monopolist firm being a price maker. But here you have to just understand in the feature of price maker that a monopolist firm existing in the monopoly market is the price maker, and all the buyers have no say in that decided price, and they are the price takers. Moving forward, barriers to entry. Now, when I say monopoly, I obviously mean there is a single seller, means I being a monopolist am putting barriers for any other firm to enter into the market. Like I told you, I am the price maker. I have the control over the price. I will choose what type of product I have to sell. Similarly, if somebody else comes into the market, he will have substitutes for my goods and my status of a monopolist will come to an end. That is why the barriers to entry exist in the monopoly market. Means as long as there is one firm operating in the market, there cannot be any other firm who will be allowed to enter in the monopoly market. And then the price discrimination. Now when you say price discrimination, you have to understand that you are a price maker. You are a single seller, but the number of buyers is very high. Now when the number of buyers is very high, there will be different section of buyers in the market. Some will belong to very poor section of the society, some will be middle class, upper middle class or higher income groups people. Now you will set the prices as you want for the product, but for example, like I said, for a 10 rupee product I am charging 3 times higher prices, let's say 30 rupees, then the poor section of the society will not be able to afford that thing. And if it goes on happening on a large scale where people are really not being able to afford your product, you will be removed from the market. So that is one thing that practically you will also consider, that जो भी आप बेच रहे हो ये सामने वाले को, you know, he should be able to afford it, right? Because if they boycott you, then you will be out of your money, you will be out of the market, somebody else is gonna replace you, correct? So he is in the position to discriminate the prices as well. This is also a factor which we will consider while understanding the profit maximization in an imperfect competition. But in short, I'll tell you what price discrimination means. Price discrimination means charging different prices for the same product to different people. What did I say? Price discrimination means charging different prices, same product, different consumers. Means you are discriminating, you are making a differentiated approach while dealing with different people. So when you think these people are like really belonging to poor sections of the society, so you can charge them little lower prices. But if you think they can afford good prices, or for example, like it happens in real life situation, when tourists, foreign tourists come in our country, I'll tell you the products that you really can afford in like 100 rupees, you can sell them in 1000 rupees also, because they are unaware of the actual prices. They do not have the knowledge of the market. So likewise, a monopolist can charge different prices for the same product to different consumers as per their ability or as per his own discretion. Since he is the one man show of the market, he is the controller and influencer of the market, he can discriminate the prices as per his own wish. Okay, he is not only the price maker but also a price discriminator, where he can charge different prices, higher or lower, for the same product to different consumers. Okay, so these are our features of how a monopoly market structure is, how a seller is the dominant person of the market, and how the buyers have no choice but to accept whatever terms and conditions the monopolist sets in the market. So now here, while understanding all these things, the two important points that I told you was price maker feature and the price discrimination feature, correct? So I am going to explain you the feature of price maker in terms of how economic profits will be earned in the monopoly market. Now why are these curves and these figures very important? Because until and unless you understand what gives a kick to the producer to, you know, maximize the profit, there is absolutely no sense of learning what a market is. Means if you are a supplier, you will want to know what gives you the maximum profit. Just understanding a particular structure will do you no good. You have to understand what elements, what decisions of the market will help you to maximize the profits. So let's take a look at how economic profits can be achieved in a monopoly market. So now, for understanding the monopoly market and the cost curves in monopoly market, what you have to do is you have to quickly compare it with how the operations were there in the perfect competition. So when you talk about monopoly, let us first draw the quantity axis and the price axis. As usual, x-axis will be the one with your quantity, correct? So now here, suppose there is an individual demand curve, correct? This is the demand curve for your particular product, and the market demand curve, all of the demand that exists in the market is your firm's demand curve, correct? Why? Because you are the single seller, okay? You are the single seller, so all the people, all the consumers in the market who demand a product will be from your own firm. So the entire market demand is your demand. So this is the demand curve. We know it slopes downward from left to right, correct? Now here, the most important distinguishing feature of monopoly, that is the imperfect competition from your perfect competition, is that the demand curve and the marginal revenue curve are not the same. Why is it? Because you are differentiating the prices, correct? So when there is a little or huge change in the prices, how will it affect? Now, taking you back a little to understanding this monopoly behavior through price elasticity, now you tell me, where will this lie? Like, if I say, being a monopolist, if I, you know, change the prices little bit, what is going to happen? Are you going to like prefer too much of things? Is your demand going to be rising by more than proportionate or less than proportionate? You just think, go back one step and remember what I told you. Higher the substitutes, higher is the elasticity degree, correct? So here we know, in monopoly, you do not have substitutes. So you have no option to raise your demand and substitute to something else. So what is going to happen? The demand curve and the marginal revenue curve are going to be steeper, okay? So this will be your marginal revenue curve, okay? Suppose this is your MR curve. MR curve will always lie below your demand curve. So let me just write here, MR curve lies below the demand curve. Correct? Now what happens, for understanding whatever profits you are going to earn, we have to draw some cost curves. Let's draw this. Suppose this is the MC curve, marginal cost curve. Now here you should have absolutely no stress, because the cost curve exists same. We have put so much time in understanding the cost curve and their shapes and the reason behind such shapes. So ultimately you will be able to draw these curves now. And then we have to draw something called as the ATC or AC, average cost curve. So if I draw this average cost curve, here also you have to remember, the MC will cut at the minimum of AC. So now we have to understand here, what is the price and what are the economic profit that a firm is going to earn. Now see, basically in your perfect competition, what you saw was where MR is equal to MC, means here, where MR is equal to MC, this should be your profit making opportunity. This should be your rational point where you are going to sell as much quantity where MR is equal to MC. But this is the imperfect competition. What point are you going to determine? This was your price in perfect competition. But let's see here, the demand curve lies above the MR, so your price will not be corresponding to this. Your price will be something which corresponds to the demand. So this is your price, and obviously the quantity that you are seeing is, suppose this is the quantity, correct? Now this is the quantity that you sell as a firm, but this is also the quantity that you will sell as a market. because one most important element is that there is absolutely no difference between monopoly firm and the monopoly market, because you are a single seller and you are the only person who is controlling the market. So aap hi firm hai aur aap hi seller hai. There is no difference between the firm and the industry. So this is the quantity of the firm and this is only the quantity of the market, and this is only the price that exists in the market, because you are the one as a monopolist who will determine the price. Now, as you can see here, as we quoted this, MR is equal to MC to the demand curve. You can see the same thing, the same point for your cost curve lies below this. This is your cost. C stands for cost. So this shaded portion right here is your economic profit. The difference between your cost curve and your price will become your economic profit. Okay, so earlier in perfect competition, what we saw, the problem was the marginal revenue curve and the demand curve and the price and the average revenue curve all were one and the same. That is the horizontal line that we saw. But here what happens is the marginal revenue is always below the demand curve. Why is this? What is the reason that the marginal revenue is below? Because when a monopolist say reduces the price for a particular unit, it means he will in general reduce the prices. He is a price discriminator. He can reduce the prices for some people or he can increase the prices for some people, and whatever he does will be on a general basis. So the additional revenue earned by selling one extra unit of his products will be lower than the total demand curve. So demand curve, this is the main issue that you have to remember here, that in case of perfect competition, the MR curve and the demand curve are one and the same, which is a horizontal straight line. Why? Because the prices are determined by market forces and then adopted by each and every firm in the same limit. But here, monopolist being the single and the only seller in the market, he has the right to discriminate the prices. So his marginal revenue curve and his demand curve will be different. So for determining the economic profit, what you have to do is, again, you have to determine the point of MR is equal to MC, because that is the basic condition for your profit maximization. But then you have to plot your prices. What price will be there? At what the demand is there? Means at what price will you sell? You will sell at a price which are reasonable for people to demand. So you will plot the corresponding thing on the demand curve and then you will plot the price on y-axis, and accordingly the same quantity determines your cost on the AC curve, and then that particular line corresponding to x-axis will determine cost, and the price minus cost is nothing but your profit, the economic profit. So having understood this economic profit, now you decide, you tell me if it is possible for a monopoly firm or the monopolist to incur losses. Can a monopolist firm incur losses? Well, it is not possible. Why is it not possible? Because he is a single seller. He will determine at what price a particular product or all of his products should be sold. Correct? So he will never incur any loss. He will always operate in the economic profit. Okay? Regarding the normal profit, where economic profits are zero, might be like in case of this world pandemic, in the global pandemic, maybe it is possible, but in practical sense, in majority of the times existing in the real life economy, he will always earn what? Positive profits, that is the economic profits. Okay, so far we will just end this concept of monopoly here. In the future sessions, we will try to see how this economic profit decisions are changing. Like I told you, the price discrimination feature, that we will study in detail, and then we will go to another type of imperfect competitions. Okay, I'll leave you here. Thank you.